Welcome back, everybody. Well, the doctor is in, and our topic today is head and neck cancers. This year, more than 52,000 Americans will develop cancer of the head and neck. Nearly 13,000, unfortunately, will die from it. Well, these statistics are from the American Academy of Otolaryngology, and I know I did not say that right, so Dr. Scott Ackerman, one of the First Coast leading oncologists, is here today to correct me on that and to talk about the different types of head and neck cancer and how many of them are curable with early detection. So that's definitely the good news.
Yes, very much the good news.
Let's talk a little bit, let's define what are the cancers of the head and the neck.
So cancers of the head and neck, people automatically think anything above the shoulders is the head and the neck area. But what we call cancers of the head and neck, they're really a collective of cancers of the throat and the upper part of the esophagus, mm-hmm. and the back part of the nasopharynx. These are the cancers that begin in the squamous cells that line the moist mucosal surfaces, mm-hmm. of the tongue and the mouth and the nose and the throat. These are collectively called head and neck cancers. We also count salivary gland tumors of the spit glands, the parotid glands, or some glands under the tongue as well. We also count these as head and neck cancers. But tumors of the brain are brain cancers, brain tumors. Tumors of the thyroid are considered thyroid, mm-hmm. cancer. They're not in the same group of cancers as head and neck cancers because even though they're in the head and neck area, they don't have the same causative agents. The treatments are different, mm-hmm. than this group of cancers that begin in the mouth and the throat. They're all treated very similarly, and the things that cause them are very similar as well.
Well, let's talk about what are some of the things that cause these types of cancers, well, in the head and the neck specifically.
Right. Well, most of these are associated with tobacco use. Many cancers, as I've mentioned before, in the lung or breast, there may be a lot of cancers that are not related to anything. But here in the upper iridigestive tract, in the head and neck area, these cancers are most closely related to tobacco use, and there's some synergy between tobacco and alcohol use.
And doctor, are we talking both types of tobacco use in terms of the smoking and also the chewing? Because you do hear a lot of concerns about that.
Smoking, whether it's a cigar or a cigarette or a pipe, chewing tobacco, all that.
All of that.
All of that. And, you know, the thing about chewing tobacco, I'm glad you brought that up. We see a lot of that in cancers of the buccal mucosa, in the mouth, the gums, and a lot of kids use chew instead of smoking, and that's led to an increased incidence of these mouth cancers in young adults. Mm-hmm. But most of it relates to tobacco, both inhalation and chew tobacco. But we see a number of cases not related to tobacco use. And we've seen more of these over the past few years. And these are cancers that we found are related to the human papillomavirus, the HPV virus, the same virus related to cervical cancer. And as I said, has been an uptick in the past couple of years. And we've identified certain things within the cancer cells that have told us that this is related to the HPV virus.
And that's been in the news a lot. So let's talk about how common are these head and neck cancers.
Well, head and neck cancers aren't one of our more common ones, not ones you hear about every day like colon cancer or breast cancer, but it accounts for about 3% of all cancers. In my practice, it's about 10 to 15% because a lot of cancers that I don't treat, cancers of the blood and those sort of things. It's more common in men than women, about twice as often as men, and it's usually diagnosed in people over the age of 50. Although these new HPV-related cancers of the head and neck happen in people a little bit younger, usually in the 30s and 40s. In the United States, it's about 52,000 people that will be diagnosed with head and neck cancer this year. And as you mentioned earlier, 13,000 will die of it. That's about 25%. And we hear about it on the news. Michael Douglas, about 2 years ago, was diagnosed with throat cancer. He had chemotherapy and radiation, and he's doing well now, but he had a rough time with that a couple of years ago.
So what are some of the signs we should look for, and then what are some of the treatments that are available?
Well, the early signs of throat cancer, head and neck cancer, is a sore in the mouth or the throat that doesn't heal, one that bleeds perhaps, cancer of the larynx with the voice box and those structures around the voice box. Those are usually the signs of early stage of cancer in that area, usually change in the voice, hoarseness, progressive hoarseness. Tumors of the base of tongue and the tonsils can present themselves as difficulty swallowing, and again, progressive difficulty swallowing. And any of these symptoms associated with ear pain is also, that's related to these cancers as well, because some of the nerves that go to the ears go through the throat, and so sometimes we see someone with hoarseness and ear pain, one of the things we think about is throat cancer.
And how are they treated?
So the patients are treated based on the site the cancer is, where it's in the throat or the tongue, the stage of the cancer, how advanced it is, whether it's just involving one structure or going to lymph nodes, the age of the patient, and their general health. Used to be we treated everybody with surgery and did some fairly large resections, but we found that by combining radiation and chemotherapy, we can preserve the form and the function of the mouth and have the same, if not a better, cure rate. But when treating with radiation therapy and chemotherapy, it's rough.
Yeah.
A lot of side effects.
That's no walk in the park. So if you're going through this kind of treatment, I know, you know, whether you're the person or the family, you want to offer support and encouragement. So let's talk a little bit about the support groups that are available.
Well, it's very important in cancer of the head and neck because compliance is very important in getting patients through treatment. Getting your treatment every day is very important to being cured. And so we have support groups. There's one here locally called SPUNK. And that's an acronym for Support for People with Oral and Head and Neck Cancer. And they offer programs to help people understand the side effects of treatment, the technological advances going on, and what tricks you could do to get through treatment more easily.
Okay. Well, Dr. Ackerman, thank you so much for joining us this morning.
Thank you.
All really good information. And, of course, thank you as well for the insight and for sponsoring this segment. And Dr. Ackerman is here with us, as you know, every Friday. But next week, he gets a break because we'll be celebrating the Thanksgiving holiday. So enjoy that
too.
With your family and your friends. And for questions regarding today's topic or any other health questions you might have, just visit firstcoastoncology.com, and you can confidentially submit your questions to Ask the Doctor.